Ave omnibus cui spectacula Metatron sequentur, ego Metatron sum. As you can imagine from the introduction, today I would like to talk about Latin. Latin, the language of the Romans. For those of you who have been watching my ancient Rome content, and I will give you some links at the end of this video if you haven't, but for those of you who have, you will have noticed that I often use either introductions in Latin or I simply use a lot of words in Latin. It is my duty to help you realize how to pronounce things and kind of shed light on this topic, if you will.
Lingua Latina. Lingua Latina is a classical language. Latin belongs to the Italic branch, which itself belongs to the Indo-European languages. The language Latin originated in Latium, the region of Italy where Rome is, and it became a dominant language thanks to the power of the Roman Republic first, and finally of the Roman Empire. But how many kinds of Latin do we have? Well, one first thing that should make us think is how long Roman history is, and therefore there are many different kinds of Latin that we can face, and all of these have differences not only in pronunciation, although that's what we will be dealing with in this video, but also with grammar, tenses for example. Now we have mentioned, and many sites out there mention mostly, Ecclesiastical Latin and Classical Latin, so let's first examine these two very briefly, then I'll give you the others. Now, when we say Classical Latin, we are talking about the language recognized by the writers of the late Roman Republic and the Roman Empire. So, for example, when we read authors, Latin authors, for instance, Marcus Tullius Cicero, considering that he was a late Republic writer, we should imagine him using Classical Latin. But the first question should be, what kind of Latin did the Romans speak before the late Republic, and what followed Classical Latin? Well, by the late Roman Republic, so we're talking about 75 BC, i.e. before the age of Classical Latin, we have what's known as Old Latin, although there are also other ways to call it, which I personally prefer, which are Early Latin or Archaic Latin. I personally choose to call it Archaic Latin. And, or if you prefer to actually use the Latin name for it, you can say Prisca Latina. That's how it's referred to in contemporary Latin. So we use Prisca, meaning ancient, rather than Vetus or Vetus, meaning old. That is also one of the reasons why I prefer not to call it Old Latin in English. Now, another kind of Latin that we have is Vulgar Latin. But please keep in mind that this is not really to be considered as a Latin that replaced Classical Latin altogether, as it was the colloquial form spoken during the same time as Classical Latin. So Vulgar Latin as opposed to Classical Latin. Vulgar Latin is important to remember because it's from Vulgar Latin that the Romance languages developed. So Italian, French, Spanish, Portuguese, Romanian, all these Romance languages come directly from Vulgar Latin. Please keep in mind that the word vulgar should be considered in its original Latin sense or meaning, which is common or vernacular. It has nothing to do with, for example, indecent or other meanings that we have given to it modernly. So, to understand the difference between these two kinds of Latin, we have to consider that all works written in Latin during classical times used classical Latin, not Vulgar Latin, which originally was called Sermo Vulgaris. Although we do have a few exceptions. The reason being its non-standard nature compared to Classical Latin. And when I say non-standard nature, I mean, for example, the lack of official orthography. In the late stage of its life, Vulgar Latin will become common Romance. We also have Late Latin. But Late Latin is kind of a continuation of Classical Latin, it being only a written language, so it is not identifiable with Vulgar Latin. So we have to consider Vulgar Latin as a colloquial language and Late Latin maintaining only the written part of Classical Latin, as nobody was speaking Classical Latin anymore. The only spoken language had become Vulgar Latin. So these are two Latin realities that coexisted together at this time. Now, as we go forward in time and we reach the Middle Ages, Of course, we have medieval Latin, which is a form of Latin that was used in the Middle Ages. But this form of Latin was used primarily as a medium of scholarly exchange, and as a liturgical language. So we are getting closer to what ecclesiastical Latin will actually be. And it was used as a language of science, literature, law, and administration. A very important point though, despite the clerical origin of many of its authors, medieval Latin is still not ecclesiastical Latin, although of course ecclesiastical means church Latin basically, but ecclesiastical Latin is in a completely different time span, and I will get there in a moment. Now, another important factor of medieval Latin is the important influence of Vulgar Latin, particularly as far as the syntax is concerned, and we see that through medieval Latin writers. Although, of course, classical Latin continued to be held in high esteem and studied as models for literary compositions. As we move forward and enter the Renaissance, Renaissance Latin will appear. It is indeed a distinctive form of Latin developed during the European Renaissance. So we're talking about 14th to 15th centuries, respectively. As we continue our trip through time, we will see the beginning of early modern Latin, and finally, Neo-Latin, or modern Latin. Modern Latin was also used originally scholarly and scientifically, and to give you precise dates, we're talking about 1375 to 1900s. Modern scholarly and technical usage, such as zoological and botanical taxonomy, and most of the international scientific vocabulary draws from new Latin vocabulary, from Neo-Latin. Ecclesiastical Latin, which can also be called liturgical Latin or church Latin, is the form of Latin language used in the Roman Rite of the Catholic Church. It can be used for liturgical purposes, but also for other purposes. Now, the difference that we will be examining in this video will be the differences between ecclesiastical Latin and classical Latin, which are mostly lexical variations and simplified syntax. And of course, the ecclesiastical Latin has more of an Italian pronunciation to it. So it's closer to Italian. One of the reasons why it's a lot easier for me to use ecclesiastical Latin as my basic pronunciation, although sometimes I enjoy using classical pronunciation. But one thing that is very important to say is that sometimes people who study classical Latin consider ecclesiastical Latin as mistakes. The pronunciation coming from ecclesiastical Latin as mistakes. They are not mistakes. It's just you're just using a different pronunciation belonging to a different time span. So whether you say Caesar, the classical pronunciation, or Cesar, the ecclesiastical pronunciation, they're both correct. It would be a mistake if I had said that the Romans said Cesar. That would be a mistake, because they said Caesar, most likely. Now, I just wanted to say this because it did happen quite often that when I chose to use ecclesiastical pronunciation, some people in the comments section told me that I was, corrected me. They were like, yep, no, in Latin it's pronounced like this, or in classical Latin it's pronounced like this. I know how it should be pronounced in classical Latin. The only thing is that sometimes I choose to use ecclesiastical Latin. I'm a down-to-earth person. If I make a mistake, I will admit it. But it has to be a mistake in the first place, and in this case, I don't think it would be. So let's start talking directly about the differences between classical Latin and ecclesiastical Latin. Let's begin with the pronunciation of the C. Now, the C has one possible pronunciation sound in classical Latin, it being K, and two possible pronunciation in ecclesiastical Latin, being K and CH. The K sound becomes a CH sound in ecclesiastical Latin when this letter is followed by these two vowels, E and E, E and E. So in that case, in ecclesiastical Latin, I would read it CHE or CHI, as opposed to the classical CHE and CHI. Let's read a little passage in Latin together. I will first read it in classical Latin, and then I will read it in ecclesiastical Latin. Centurio. Centurio fuit miles in exercitu Romano, cui centum milites duxit. Centurio. Centurio fuit miles in exercitu Romano, cui centum milites duxit. Now, another sound that I would like to examine is the V sound. Now, this letter in classical Latin is always pronounced as a U sound. U. In ecclesiastical Latin, be it being closer to Italian, it is instead pronounced with a V sound. So at the beginning of the video, when I say Ave Omnibus, I'm actually using ecclesiastical Latin, because Ave in classical Latin would have been Ave, Ave Omnibus. An example of this would be the very famous phrase Veni, Vidi, Vici, which in ecclesiastical Latin will be read Veni, Vidi, Vici. Now the next sound that I would like to examine is the GN sound. In classical Latin, it will be pronounced as a GN sound, whereas in ecclesiastical Latin, it will be closer to Italian, it will be read as N sound. So, for example, the Roman kingdom would be read Regnum Romanum, and in ecclesiastical, Regnum Romanum. Now, another interesting part is the diphthongs. So, for example, the combination of vowels. The A plus E vowel in classical Latin is read just as it's written. So we read it as ae, ae. In ecclesiastical Latin instead, the sound will be simplified to e, e. So we see the name of Caesar in Latin, classical Latin, Caesar, Caesar. Ecclesiastical Latin, Caesar, Caesar. Another example is the name of this town in southern Italy, Paestum, Paestum, Pestum, Pestum. The same situation happens with the OE diphthong. Now, moving on to the vowels, and this part here will be important for Anglophone speakers, because this is one of the problems that I see in many sites. How do you pronounce vowels in Latin? Well, in Latin we have basically 10 vowels, 5 short vowels and 5 long vowels. Now, vowels is one of the main problems with internet sites out there, particularly for you who speak English as a first language or who are using English as a means to learn Latin because simply you don't understand Italian or other Romance languages. Long vowels. A, E, I, O, U. So you will have noticed that often in internet sites and also on YouTube, they tell you that the O, the long O, you need to pronounce it like the O in note. That's wrong, because the O in English of note has a little U there. O, O, at least in British English. But I think even in American, it's kind of similar. I don't have an American accent, but it's similar to a little, very small U there. I don't think that Americans or English people say not. But to create the real sound, you just need to make the O longer. O, O. U is U, not U, not U. It's U, U. E is the only good example that I could find in these sites, and that's like the E in machine. Machine, so it's E, okay? So it's closer to the sound that you have in English when you have two E, like in scene, E. E, terrible. They tell you to pronounce it like they. That's wrong, because if you pronounce it like they, you will have a E at the end there. A lot of people make this mistake. In fact, they say tres, but it's tres, tres. So there's no E. E, E, E. A, they say like in father. It's all right, I suppose, although you do have several accents in English. So anyways, just make it longer. Ah, ah. You don't really need to put it all the way back into your throat. It just needs to be pronounced in the center of your mouth. Ah, not ah, ah. Short vowels is where we have a disaster normally on YouTube tutorials and videos and an internet site. The short ah, it's just ah, ah. Okay, so don't consider it like, for example, America, because that's more of a at the end. That would be wrong. So ah, ah, it has a full sound. It's shorter, but it's full. Ah, the small e, they say like in met or pet. That is correct. Like red e, e sound e. The small, the short e is another problem, because they tell you to pronounce it like the short, like the English word pit or hit. That's wrong, because think about it. An Italian accent or a Spanish accent or a French accent, when we speak English, we have a problem here, because we don't have this sound that you have, the sound. So we don't say pit, sit, Limerick, but we say pit, sit, hit, Limerick, right? And that is exactly the sound that you should pronounce when you're speaking Latin. E sound. E. E. Okay? It's just shorter. But it's not pit, sit, ship. That's a different thing. It's a sound. Italian. In fact, I had to learn it. When I first started learning English, I would say Italian, but of course I learned that it's Italian, sit, etc. Well, that's a sound that you should learn yourself when you, if you want to speak Latin. U, short U, they say to say like in put. Kind of. I would just say just repeat after me. I think that's the best way out. It's U, U, as opposed to U of the longer one. So, having seen all this, let's read a bit of Latin so you can practice. Imperium. Imperium. Imperium.
Exercitus Romanus. Exercitus Romanus magna potestate militari non coepit, sed tempore ab una conclexione militum in multas minores centurias intra maiores legiones crevit.
Alright, I hope that you enjoyed this video, that I wasn't too boring as a teacher, and I thank you for your time. And remember, the Metatron has spread his wings. Valete.